So if you think about Scrum, you're trying to embrace a more agile mindset. You're using the Scrum as a framework, an empirical framework for helping your team embrace a more agile mindset. Remember, an empirical framework allows you to inspect and adapt, kind of like how I was describing the Shavar. You know, you're twisting the dials and seeing what happens. Now, this is still, it's 80% of software products now use some sort of agile approach, but there's still a chunk of software products that don't. And there's still some teams that use kind of what they call the hybrid approach, where they've got some sort of old processes that they use and then some new with Scrum. And the old sort of processes are often based on something called Waterfall, which was based on a paper from Winston Royse back in 1970. And so this Waterfall approach was based on manufacturing. And it's sort of, you broke down this way to deliver projects, not products, but projects, into these phases. So you had sort of this planning phase, and you had an analysis or an analyze phase. You had a design phase, and then you had a develop phase, and then a test phase, and then a deploy phase. So the idea was is that you would start out in your project, and then one team would work on one chunk, and then hand it off to the next team, then hand it off to the next team, sort of in a waterfall approach, as it sort of as it goes down through your across your organization through the different functional areas. And so some Scrum teams would sort of use a little bit of this waterfall phase, or this waterfall stuff would kind of end up in the processes, in the Scrum processes. And you'll see this sometimes if your Scrum team has a project manager, and they'll try to make sure that you're delivering something on time, or they'll talk about scope or something like that. Or sometimes you'll have testers in your team that aren't interested in development because they're used to this waterfall style of working, where they're just like, well, you give it to me at the end because that's where I am in the stage of the waterfall. Or you'll have to Scrum team sort of hand off your work to an entirely different deployment team or something like that. And so some Scrum teams have to watch out for these hybrid processes where you have kind of this empirical Scrum framework where you're supposed to inspect and adapt, but it's still kind of being, there's still some legacy processes based on this old waterfall model, which came from manufacturing, where some of these processes end up impacting the team. So it's kind of, it's good to sort of think about the waterfall so that you can think about if it does impact the team, how you might be able to make changes to sort of either work with the organization to get some of these waterfall processes out of the team, or try to figure out a way that maybe it's the way that if your organization is heavily dedicated to waterfall, it might be very difficult to run a Scrum team. But the earlier you start thinking about the waterfall and its impact on Scrum, the easier it'll be for your team to succeed. So you have to think about, again, these phases. Now, when Winston Royce came up with this waterfall model for software development, or basically adapted this waterfall model from manufacturing to software development, he said himself that, I believe in this concept, but the implementation described above is risky and invites failure. So this is back in 1970, way before app stores and things like that, and way before software development became such a huge industry. And so he was pointing out in 1970 that this would invite failure. And he was right. One of the challenges with this waterfall phase is that when you do spend a lot of time planning, and there's a lot of time in between planning and deployment, then there's a lot of things that can happen. There's a lot of obstacles that can come up that will help make it very difficult for you to deploy what you've planned maybe months or years ago. And this was, again, part of the inspiration for the Agile Manifesto in the first place. And so you should think about this waterfall processes, but you should also think about the difference between how agile teams or Scrum teams view their sort of processes compared to waterfall. So if you think about looking at this waterfall phase, as each phase goes down, it becomes more difficult, more costly for you to make changes. So if you come up with a terrific plan for how you're going to create your software product, and you need to make a change near deployment, then it's going to cost a huge amount of money because you'll have to go back up the waterfall and figure out how to redesign it, you'll have to retest it, and whatever. And so Scrum kind of takes this waterfall phase and looks at it quite a bit differently. So some of the challenges around this waterfall phased approach come up in something called the cone of uncertainty. Remember that in the waterfall approach, you've got planning, you've got analysis, you've got design, test, deployment, you've got all these phases in the waterfall. But when you're thinking about software development, you've got to think about when you know the most about what your customer wants or what the product will do. And the challenge with software products is that you don't necessarily know everything that you need to know at the beginning. And so you've got this cone of uncertainty. Now, I spend a fair amount of time in Florida. And so in Florida, they have these things called hurricanes that come by. There's this hurricane season around October where these hurricanes come through and caused tremendous problems in Florida. And so, but one of the challenges with hurricanes is if you're sitting in Florida, you don't really know where the hurricane's going to hit. There's this kind of cone of uncertainty. Is you'll be watching the news and they'll say, hey, there's our tropical storm forming off the coast of Florida. And so it could go anywhere from Jacksonville to Miami, which is sort of basically the entire coast. And so they don't really know. And then as it gets closer, then they start to say, okay, well, we figured out that it's going to be in between Fort Lauderdale and Miami. But again, that's still a pretty good chunk of the coast. And then as it gets closer and closer and closer, they can pinpoint where exactly the hurricane's going to hit. And so you've got like this cone of uncertainty as the hurricane starts to reach landfall. And so you have something very similar in software development. You've got this sort of massive software product where people are thinking different ideas about what the product will do. And you come up with all these great ideas and you start to think about it in the planning stage. And so you've got like this planning stage where you're coming up with all these ideas, but you don't really know exactly all the functions and features that your customer is going to want in the deployment phase. That's where this cone of uncertainty comes in. And yet, it's the most expensive to make changes at the very end of the cone. And so you've got to make all of these choices when it's inexpensive to make changes, but then the consequences of those choices will happen when it's really extremely expensive to make changes. So if you were going to develop a software product and you make all these choices, and then a month before you're going to deploy the product, there's a bunch of changes, then you have to redo all this work and becomes very expensive. So Scrum looks at this challenge in sort of a slightly different way. And so if you're looking at this massive software product, which a lot of Scrum teams work on, the best way to sort of think about it is to break it up into different chunks. And so if you're going to chunk out sort of your software product from beginning and end to the end, and you're going to sort of try to break it down into these two-week sprints so that you can inspect and adapt your way all the way through the cone of uncertainty. It's kind of like that old joke that if you want to eat an elephant, you sort of have to start one bite at a time. And so these software products are like massive elephants. They're like massive things that you have to sort of figure out how to break down into chunks. And so a good product owner will try to work like a heat-seeking missile over time and kind of find your way to the customer, the highest value functions and features, that 7% that we saw earlier, for your customer. So your product owner will kind of be looking to figure out what that 7% is as you work through your cone of uncertainty. Because remember that it gets more expensive as you move along if you're using sort of a more traditional approach, because you don't want to be making massive changes right before you're about to deploy this software product that you've used a traditional waterfall approach. And so if you're thinking of it more with using an agile mindset, then you want to break it down into these little chunks if you're using Scrum, which are called sprints, so that you can deliver the software incrementally and focus in on the highest value stuff like a heat-seeking missile. So instead of like there being a big unveil at the end, you're sort of improving and iterating the product over time. So if you think back to how I was talking about how they manufacture cars, the customer will go and they'll come up with a design, and then they'll come up with a plan for a new car, and then they'll come up with a design, and then the engineers will work on it, and then they'll create the sort of a test version, and then you'll see the car driving around, and then they'll finally deploy to the customer. And there's a big unveil where they pull back the sheet, and then there's the working car. You don't want to use that same approach with software, because at the very end is when you have, it's the most expensive to make changes. So if you use something like Scrum, you're going to want to break down that product into smaller chunks so that you can avoid the challenges with this cone of uncertainty. And so if you compare the two, if you have sort of like this big design up front, sometimes it's called stage gate or big design up front or waterfall style process for delivering software. Remember, you've got the waterfall. We've plan, analyze, design, code, test, and then deploy. So it's similar to how you work in manufacturing, is you're going through all these stages, and then there's these handoffs between these different stages. Now, if you compare that to what you're doing with Scrum, you've got all of these phases squeezed down into a sprint. So each sprint, you should be doing all of these activities. And with Scrum, it was based a little bit on an old paper called The New Product Development Game. They described it almost like a slice of sashimi, where you have, if you are familiar with sushi, where you have sort of a small slice of the fish that sort of is indicative of the whole. So you have like a small slice, but it has all of the little parts in it. And so that's what these sprints are, is they're like little sashimis. They're like little, they have all of the phases in the waterfall, and you do it every 2 weeks. And so every 2 weeks on a Scrum team, you should plan, analyze, design, code, test, and deploy. And then every sprint, you're gonna be doing all of these phases: plan, analyze, design, test, code, and deploy. And so in each one of them is squeezed down into a two-week sprint to sort of eliminate these handoffs. And remember what we talked about with multitasking, where you've got this sort of context switching in between. So you're focused completely on all of these phases at once and delivering in a two-week sprint. Now, this might seem like it's, this might seem like it's a very challenging thing to do in your organization. It's true, but you have to think about the sort of the efficiencies that you can gain by doing these two-week sprints, where you're doing all the phases in the waterfall instead of these massive handoffs between these different sort of phases if you're doing a traditional approach. Okay, so let's try a question to sort of see where we're at, to see sort of if you can have anything that you may want to go over or something like that, just to review what we've gone over. So imagine that you're trying to convince your manager to try and use Scrum on your next software development product, and your manager asks why sprints are important. So what would be the best way to respond to your manager? So you could say, hey, they help the project maintain a sustainable pace. Or you could say, hey, they give interested parties an opportunity to participate. Or they say, see, they allow the team to adapt and make changes throughout the product. Or you could say all of these things, so all of the above. So which do you think is the correct answer? Yeah, it's D, all the above. Sprints are essential to the Scrum framework. You have to think about the time box. You're doing all the phases of the time box in a two-week sprint. They help improve the coordination and the communication, and they help distribute the workload. It's a key part of helping your team sort of maintain a more agile mindset. It's a key concept in agility. Now remember, you've got these time boxes, which are your sprints. They should be every 2 weeks. You should stick with 2 weeks or whatever. Usually it's 2 weeks, but then you should stick to it. You shouldn't make the time box grow or get smaller. And then you need to make sure that you do all the phases. If your organization is familiar with doing something like traditional waterfall approach, you've got the phases, but you'll be working as a cross-functional team, essentially doing all of those phases every 2 weeks. And then you deliver predictably over time. And that's one of the ways that you avoid the challenges with the cone of uncertainty, where you're not forced to make all the decisions about your product when you know the least about what it's going to be. And so again, you're building it up through iterations over time, squeezing all the phases in a typical waterfall project into a sprint, keeping it time boxed to 2 weeks, and delivering the highest value work every sprint.